Hi, and welcome to the We Are One Global Film Festival. My name is Ben Thompson. I'm the short film programmer for the Tribeca Film Festival. And you've just been watching Blood Rider, directed by Jon Kasbe. And we're very fortunate to have the director, John, and Temie Giwa-Tubosun from LifeBank to talk a little about the film and the organization that is involved in the film. So I'm going to go straight in and ask some questions. Thank you so much to both of you for being here. So John, when myself and my quite welcome. So when myself and my programming colleague Sharon were watching the film, we were really blown away by this incredible story and how it was kind of put together. I wonder if you could first talk a little about what drew you to this particular story and to your connection to Nigeria as well.
Yeah, so the first film I'd done was called When Lambs Become Lions, which actually played at Tribeca. And that was the first feature I'd done in Kenya. And after that project, I was looking for something new to do that would be equally as immersive, but also about an issue that we really felt was important and people needed to hear more about. And Google actually is the one who found this story with LifeBank and heard about how they were using technology to kind of connect hospitals with blood banks with blood delivery riders. You know, we didn't know a lot about this going in, but it was very clear that there was a really unique situation here in the sense that they were getting accustomed to these unpredictable circumstances and finding ways to solve them. And it was really about delivering blood to hospitals that needed it urgently in very quick amounts of time. And due to, you know, very congested traffic, it was clear that it takes a very long time. So it was taking, you know, up to 24 hours to do this. And LifeBank was finding a way to do it under an hour consistently. So that stat alone just kind of blew us away. And we became very curious as to how they were doing this. So we started talking with Timmy and with LifeBank and learning more about their process and realizing that they'd become so good at it that it was kind of predictable in certain ways. And we started realizing that if we put enough cameras in enough places, we could actually capture the whole thing in a way that didn't necessarily inform people about what was going on, but gave them a feeling, the opportunity to experience what it was actually like on an emotional level to be there and to go through it.
How did you set up for a process? You mentioned you were kind of following multiple subjects. I think that's in the text at the beginning, and this, but the logistics must have been kind of staggering to follow all of these stories, and the whole film feels like it's in real time, and was it?
Yeah, so we had about a month in Lagos to work on this, and during that time, you know, we planted seeds with a lot of different people because we wanted to have as many options as possible. So I think at the beginning, I probably met with about 40 women that were pregnant, planning to give birth in the next, you know, 3 to 6 weeks. And of those, 10 of them agreed to be a part of over there. 3 of them gave birth. And so that, you know, kind of spreading out and having a lot of options made it possible to actually document the process of one of them having blood delivered to them. And, you know, during that time, we had another camera crew that was following the drivers, so following Joseph, but other motorcycle drivers at LifeBank. On all of these deliveries. And it was kind of this game in a lot of ways of trying to do the work and having the patience to create the highest likelihood of seeing blood delivered and saving someone. Because we kept hearing from these drivers about this happening all the time. But in our minds, we were really interested in being able to see two threads independently and then see them kind of converge at the end. So that's always what we were working towards creatively and in our minds. And you know, in a lot of ways, it felt unrealistic. Like, I felt like there's no way we'll be able to capture this. But due to the fact that we had 4 weeks there and we had 2 camera crews, we're able to kind of spread out our resources and ultimately get kind of lucky.
I actually want to ask Temie a question as well, because I'm assuming LifeBank played a huge role in this process as well, since it's the organization that is kind of pioneering this. Temie, can you speak a little about, for the viewers, LifeBank, why you founded it and what its kind of mission is as well?
Thank you so much for your kind question. Absolutely. When we got this opportunity to tell our story by the Google team, we're really thrilled. and excited. And of course, I had watched a couple of John's work, and I saw sort of like the narrative and the immersive way that he told stories, and I was really interested in that. I thought that we had a strong story. You know, we're a medical distribution company. We deliver this critical mm-hmm. supplies round the clock to these hospitals in developing countries. I always thought we had a lovely story, and I'm not biased at all. So I was really excited for him to tell it in his special way. So we made sort of like the relationships happen. We introduced him to the great hospitals. We also wanted to be careful in the way we told the story. It wasn't about, poverty porn, see all these poor people in Africa. Mm-hmm. We wanted to tell a real story where, here was a great writer who has been committed, inexplicably committed to the work. And it has a really powerful story, and also it's the story of the business as well, and all the structures that are around him to make sure that he can do this great work and be so impactful in doing what we do.
I don't think a lot of people realize how a serious kind of maternal mortality is, especially in childbirth, and how critical blood is in need and as a supply. I mean, I know everybody knows we need blood to survive, but we don't think of it as a resource in hospitals, particularly in this country where we just don't have it. How did this kind of blood rider and network start, and how did LifeBank begin working with them as well? Or did you start it?
Right. Thank you for that great question. Of course, you're right. Access to blood is so critical for women who are delivering babies. Here you are doing this incredible service to the world, and then you're bleeding, and then within a couple of minutes, you're dead. So postpartum hemorrhage is a very big problem. It is a catastrophic problem, mm-hmm. and it's a problem that's pretty common. It is pretty common across most developing countries. It isn't just a Nigerian problem. It's not just an African problem. It's a problem you find in most developing countries. Basically, institutions or countries that have not figured out the infrastructure to deliver these critical supplies around the clock. So postpartum hemorrhage happens to women. It's not a problem that only happens to women in developing countries. But the difference between death and living is that infrastructure, that distribution, that platform that's already there, that's silent, that you won't know about when you go to the hospital, but that makes sure that women survive childbirth. That was sort of like the problem we were trying to solve at LifeBank, to be that silent, that, round the clock partner and infrastructure and that platform to make sure that anytime a woman delivers a baby, she gets access to all the supplies that she needs, blood mm-hmm. products, oxytocin, whatever it is she needs to make sure that the baby survives and that she does as well.
It's an incredible organization and incredible work that you do. And I think that really knowing that kind of just raises the stakes of the story so much. I mean, John, you're telling these kind of two stories that intersect so incredibly. Can you speak a little about how you found specifically Deborah and Joseph? As well as subjects, and what it was like to, it's a very intimate film. We're seeing kind of parts of their lives as well, not just the day of the birth and the blood drive. Can you talk a little about that as well?
Yeah, different process, picking the blood writer and picking the pregnant woman that would give birth. With picking the blood writer, we were instantly really drawn to Joseph. I mean, we started this process out by spending a day, probably like a half day with each writer. Not filming, not having a camera on me, but actually just doing the rounds with them and trying to get an experience and a small feeling for what it's actually like. And it was very clear as soon as I got on the back of the bike with Joseph that he's extremely fast and he's fearless. I just felt this anxiety and this fear being on the back of a bike with him. And it made me realize straight away, like, you know, we had come there with this gear and with this plan of shooting it in a certain way. And it made me realize very quickly from being on a bike with Joseph that this should be filmed in a way that's chaotic and shaky and messy, because that's the reality of how this guy is riding and how mm-hmm. he's going to these, like, he's kind of trading one danger for another. And then we had lunch that day, and he started telling me about these stories of how, you know, he in the past he'd arrived minutes late and had someone die because of the delivery time. And just like having that weight on his shoulders at all times, and knowing that every single time a call for blood is placed, it's his responsibility to go as fast as he possibly can. And you could really feel that in the way that he, you know, from the way he put on his uniform to the way he rode his bike to the way he like ran into hospitals with this blood. So it was clear that Joseph was going to be the blood rider that we really wanted the film to be about, but we didn't necessarily have the luxury of, you know, a lot of it depended on who ended up bringing the blood to the person that was giving birth. And so in terms of picking Deborah, we really liked Deborah, and she was one of our favorites, but we were kind of just hedging our bets to see, like, you know, who ends up giving birth, who ends up needing blood. And that was kind of what was going to determine who the pregnant woman character was going to be. I mean, that ended up being Deborah, and Joseph ended up being the one that came to the hospital at that time. And so we were, you know, I remember at that point we'd been camping out at that hospital for about 4 days. And right before Deborah went into labor, we missed another woman who we'd spent a week filming with. We missed her birth by minutes. And so we were just like really not wanting to miss this one, because we'd kind of made that mistake in the past. But yeah, the stars really kind of aligned at the end, and they kind of became the cross section of what the whole arc was built on.
It's incredible. You're right there with both of them. We're in the delivery room, we're on the bike. It's, you know, you build up such a personal connection to the story, and you should be commended for the incredible job you did. And thank you. I just want to end with one more question for Temie, since, I mean, we're doing this as a virtual festival because of kind of the COVID-19 pandemic that's ravaging the world. How has that affected kind of LifeBank's work, and what challenges are you facing currently?
Right. You know, we're critical essentials. Like I say, babies don't, you know, say just because COVID is out there, we're not going to be, you know, we're not going to come. Babies don't, you know, come on schedule. So we're still critical. Our riders are still out there delivering critical supplies all through COVID, you know, which brings additional complexity to what we do. We have to make sure the riders are protected. We have to make sure that hospital teams are protected. We did a lot of frontline work for COVID. We built testing center in 2 locations in Nigeria. We now added medical oxygen to what we deliver, particularly because of medical oxygen is so critical to delivering, to helping people who have COVID-19. So we're delivering medical oxygen across different states, across different areas in Nigeria. We have so much more work to do, but it's work that, you know, for us, I feel like we've been preparing for this moment for a very long time, quietly, slowly but surely building a strong platform, strong system that can sort of, like, you can add another product to it and it just works seamlessly. Mm-hmm. And I think for our team, for our delivery team, our fulfillment team, the reason why they're so important to the health systems, to the infrastructure, is now clear to them. And I think it's just like another way of, you know, reiterating why they're so important to the country and why their work is so needed.
Well, thank you so much, Temie, to the incredible work your organization does. Thank you so much, Jon, for bringing it to life and capturing it in such an incredible way. And thank you for being part of this festival. I think that's all we have time for, but a huge thank you from everyone.